So where we left off from the last video is we're saying, okay, the main is the main compilation unit. Basically, the main is kind of the go button for your entire application. And we prove that by just typing in a simple line right here. Now, if I were to copy this line now, or to put it outside of main, first of all, it would confuse Eclipse. And Eclipse would say, hey, I don't know what that thing is doing out there. You better get that inside of a method or get it inside of main, or else we don't know what to do with it. So Eclipse is going to say, sorry, but that doesn't make any sense, what you just did right out there. So they're saying, hey, if you could just delete that for me. So what I can do is I can kind of double click on it a few times, and then I can just delete from there. But sometimes, if you press Control Z, undo that. Sometimes if you kind of made an error, but you kind of did something valuable that you learned from, what you do is you just type two slashes right next to it. And that will make it kind of invisible to the compiler, and the compiler will kind of ignore it. And it will create it as a what's called a single line comment. Comments are really valuable to programmers because they sort of provide some instructions as to what we should do. And so if you're creating an algorithm or a solution, you want to kind of make your steps ahead of time, and then you kind of fill in the blanks as you go. Let me just say this. Simply envisioning a correct algorithm is a solution in itself, the same way that a blueprint is a solution to an architecture before it gets built. Good recipes precede good products. And let me give you a little bit of kidding. Guys, grandma calls algorithms recipes. Recipes and algorithms are the same thing. If you go and you visit with your grandma and you say, hey, I'm learning a lot about algorithms, she may go a little glassy-eyed. But if you say to her, grandma, I'm learning recipes, how to make millions of dollars, she may get interested. Okay? Recipes and algorithms are the same thing. Recipes have steps to follow, right? And algorithms in Java work the same way. So we want to use our multi-line comments. So main is going to be our main compilation unit. Now, within this class, we're very interested in creating a digital stock market. But really, markets are made of stocks, right? It's a place where we sell stocks. So in order for us to have stocks inside of this market, we should probably create the primary building block of the market, which is a stock. So let's do that. So we said, okay, stock, it's called L, and we could call, you know, this stock, or we could call it, you know, a stock called M, or we could call it S, T, or CK. Or I like L because L appears inside of a lot of calculus, so it kind of, it's kind of there in my mind, L for, you know, limit or what have you. So that stock is a new stock. So what I realize is that there's this kind of square error right there. Whenever you see a square error inside of Eclipse, you really want to click on that. It's like having an advent calendar at Christmas. You really want to open up that window because it's telling you something that you really want to know. So it's giving you all these options to fix the error. And the errors are going to be the red underlined stuff. But if you were to follow a lot of these steps, different stuff would happen. So actually, Eclipse kind of understands a little bit of the error that you made, and it's kind of guessing what the solutions will be. But you do, in fact, need to make the right decision. So in this case, we're actually going to create a class called Stock. And we do not put the main there because we only have one main per project. If you have a video game that takes millions of lines, or a Google algorithm that has a lot of artificial intelligence, again, millions of lines, there's still only one main to Google, right? Google has a main, but only one. So per system, you only create one main per system. So when you make new objects or new classes, you don't put a main in there. You can, but it'll just, you know, it'll just be an error. So we'll go finish. And so stock jumps up over here, and you can notice inside of the project, there's the brain center, and then there's the stock. That's great. So it's ready to go. And I might want to put some documentation. So you know how to make a single line comment. Now I'm going to make a multi-line comment. So I put the two asterisks after my slash. And I'm going to say the stock represents one security on a stock exchange in our simulation. You'd be surprised how much money is traded every day by Java programs. Wall Street is turning into Programmer Alley, where programmers are flooding in there, coding algorithms that intelligently buy up stock based upon certain preferences. Like, what stock should I buy? So Wall Street is really a dialogue between programs that are exchanging billions of dollars every day. They frequently make a lot of money. The irony of this is, well, if they succeed for another 10 years, maybe we'll just entrust Social Security to Wall Street in the form of programs which have proven themselves to be reliable. Why not? The entire IRS is a huge supercomputer. If you get your refund within a week of having submitted your taxes, it's thanks to a big application that runs inside of the IRS. If you would have said to the generation 2 decades ago, oh, you know what? In the future, the IRS is just going to be a big computer, they would have said, boy, let's not have that happen. All sorts of disaster will take place. But as you can see now, it took us some time, but the IRS is very reliable. And if you could say, maybe it's a little too efficient, but it's very efficient because of the fact that it's a gigantic program. So we're not joking that programmers occupy governing seats in this culture, you know, including on the stock market. So just going to say that, just to toot my own horn, but what information should be present within a stock? When you think about a stock, you know, it probably has a symbol, and it probably has a price, and it probably has an IPO quantity, which is the initial number of stock, the initial number of stock on sale. And what other stuff? Well, maybe it has, it's part of an industry. You know, maybe it belongs to some industry. You know, so that's pretty good. So I'll save that. You notice there's a little asterisk right there. I want to save that. And I'm going to go back to my brain center. And I want to say, okay, L is my, and I want to say, populate the stock with some information. So I want to say L dot industry for this stock is going to be, let's say it's in the locomotive industry. It's a locomotive stock. And let's say it's price. You know, and you notice that once I type in my little dot, you know, Eclipse kind of, it goes into all the information inside of stock and it kind of makes this available. And partly the reason why this nice thing is happening that makes me work so quickly, the reason why that's happening is because I use the term public. Public variables that are inside of a class become visible outside of that class when I want to use them in another class. So public, a public variable is visible outside the class by other classes. Now, Brain Center is a class. So I could say L dot price. Maybe its initial price is a $55 stock. It's quite expensive. And then maybe its IPO quantity. Let's say I have a large, let's say I have 50, 123, 123, a large public offering of that type. Oh, I typed 55 wrong. Isn't that interesting? Now, 55 is going to work well if I go 55.0 because the price is a double, which is a number with decimals. Does that make sense? Versus the IPO quantity, it's an integer, which is no decimals. And right up top here, the industry, it's a string or word, which is a string of characters. And so we're able to represent alphanumeric data using a string type. We're able to represent, you know, decimal or precise numbers using a double. And we're able to represent integer values using the integer type. And what else? So we have four. Oh, we have a symbol, the all-important symbol. So let's go down and let's make that symbol is equal to GE. That's great. and maybe we're in the GE locomotive business. And for our simulation, we'll assign a randomly determined symbol names. Okay. And let me do this last bit, system.out.println, stock named L.symbol. Is priced at L.price. And do you want to predict what it will do? Here, let's eliminate that. What it's going to do is it's going to print, well, GEL, stock name GEL, is priced at 55. And when I slip in a little number sign there, and let's give that a run. Stock name GEL is priced at 55 bucks. Pretty cool. We're off and running, aren't we? So we have the beginnings. And so what I'm most interested in is I'm saying, well, if I'm going to make a stock market, hopefully I can very reliably duplicate the properties of a stock in data. Now, this is what you call an abstraction. It's something very simple that represents something complex, but the abstraction can contain all the details that you find relevant. But for us, in the beginning stages of the simulation, we should be able to duplicate the properties of a stock. So I'll just make sure all your stuff's backed up right there. Let's give it a final run. Here's where we'll be leaving off when we pick up in a moment.